Good morning, dear brothers and sisters. A blessed Easter to one and all. My name is Guo Yong. I'm one of the pastors here at Katong Presbyterian Church. Welcome to our Easter Sunday service. It is an absolute joy and privilege to be able to celebrate Jesus' resurrection, especially that we are able to celebrate together as God's family during these very, very tough times. And the Apostle Paul often called us that whenever we come together to greet one another with a holy kiss. I know that can't be done because the virus is going around, but we still want to welcome and greet one another. So why don't we just rise and with your greatest smile in your eyes, you can wave to one another and say, Happy Easter, Jesus is risen, right? Let's tell each other that it is time to celebrate. Thank you very much. And so please be seated. Before I hand the time over to our worship leader, we are going to have the order changed a little bit today. I will bring us the announcement first, and then after that, we will worship in songs. So let's put up the first announcement slide. It's about KPC's annual congregational meeting. It will be held on the 25th of this month at 11 a.m. And there will be a combined service on that same Sunday at 9:30 a.m. with our Chinese congregation. A letter has been mailed to all of us, if you are a member of the church, with the instructions on how to vote and how to sign up for the meetings on that day. So please read the letters carefully. Because of COVID-19, our meeting procedures have to be adjusted. If you need help with filling in the online forms, a help desk will be set up for you on the 11th and 18th of this month, which is next Sunday and the Sunday after that. So just come to church, and on one of these Sundays that I've mentioned, you'll be able to get help from the help desk. But if you are worshiping from home and you couldn't come to church, don't worry. If you need help, just give our administrator a call. Right, to the next announcement, Life Explored. This is a series to help us discover how Christ meets our deepest needs. And how Christ gives us meaning and purpose in life. So it is a series that will be run for 7 Saturdays at 10:30 a.m. from the 10th of April, that is the coming Saturday. So if you have a friend whom you think will benefit from the course, sign up together with him, or you can sign up for yourself. So for more information, you can refer to our e-bulletin. These are the 2 announcements that I'll bring you this morning, and I'll now hand the time over to our worship leader, Marian.
Good morning and blessed Easter to one and all. Shall we rise and read today's call to worship, taken from Book of Luke, chapter 24, and verses 1 to 9. Okay. Together, on the first day of the week, very early in the morning, the women took the spices they had prepared and went to the tomb. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb, but when they entered, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. While they were wondering about this, suddenly 2 men in clothes that gleamed like lightning stood beside them. In their fright, the women bowed down with their faces to the ground, but the men said to them, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here. He has risen. Remember how he told you while he was still with you in Galilee. The Son of Man must be delivered over to the hands of sinners, be crucified, and on the 3rd day be raised again." Then they remembered his words. When they came back from the tomb, they told all these things to the 11 and to all the others. Indeed, we worship a risen Savior today, and may we declare that praise to him through our hearts as we sing silently, as we celebrate Easter today. And we'll start with the song, "Come People of the Risen King."
Bring him praise. Come all and tune your heart.
praise God that we can come and rejoice as people of the risen King. The next song, Crown Him with Many Crowns, is a simple yet profound declaration that Christ is many things and everything. I read something about this song, and the author said he is Lord of all, to be crowned for many things that all add up to him being Savior of the world. And each crown represents a different aspect of who Christ is. He is the Lord of life, Lord of love, Lord of years, Lord of heaven. He is the Lamb upon the throne. Christ is King, Servant, Lamb, Shepherd. And today we celebrate this all-encompassing nature of our Savior by crowning Him the Lord of all. And we sing together, Crown Him.
Crown Him with many crowns, the Lamb upon His throne. Hark how the heavenly anthem drowns, all music but in song. Awake my soul and sing of Him who died for thee. And hail Him as thy matchless King through all eternity.
This is Crown Him the Lord of life, who triumphed over the grave.
Lord of life, who triumphed over the grave and rose victorious in the strife for those He came to save. His glories now we sing, who died and on high, who died eternal life to bring, and lived that death may die.
He's the Lord of love. Let's crown Him today.
Crown Him the Lord of love. Rich wounds yet visible above, in beauty glorified. No angels in the sky can fully bear that sigh, but downward bends each burning eye.
Lord of years, the potentate of time, creator of the universe.
Crown Him the Lord of years, the potentate of time, creator of the rolling spheres, ineffably sublime.
Never fail throughout eternity. Let's come to Him in prayer as we prepare for a time of confession before Him. Dear Lord, how can we ever thank You enough for coming? coming into this world to give your life for us. Yeah, we allow ourselves to be weighed down by sin or distracted by the temptations of this world. Lord, we are sorry for the times we get so busy that we fail to remember the incredible love you willfully demonstrated to us by going to the cross. We confess, Lord, that we are great sinners in need of your forgiveness. So hear our prayers of individual confession to you, Lord. We realize afresh today what your death and resurrection mean for us. It means forgiveness, freedom, the ability to walk with you through this fallen world into eternity. May we always find our satisfaction in you and your willingness to offer yourself to us. Thank you, Lord, for dying on the cross for our sins. And thank you, Lord, for rising so that we can have eternal life with you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Peace of the Lord be with you. Let's pass the peace, non-contact version. Christ's death has paid the full payment of our sins. Jesus declared on the cross, "It is finished." So let us declare together with him, with a thankful heart, Christ's victory over evil, because it was finished upon that cross.
Jesus paid the price for me, full the pardon he has offered, great the welcome that I receive. Boldly I approach my Father, clothed in Jesus' righteousness. There is no more guilt to carry, it was finished upon that cross. Death was once my great opponent, fear once had a hold on me, but the Son who died to save us rose that we would be.
Death was once my
great opponent. Fear once had a hold on me, but the Son who died to save us rose that we would be free indeed. Yes, he rose that we would be free indeed, free from every bed of darkness, free to
was finished upon that cross. Thank you. Please be seated.
Okay, it is offering. So now let us bring before God our offering. We cannot outgive God, but we can show our thankfulness and our appreciation to God for His love and His blessings to us through giving of our time, our services, and our finances. So as we have the offering this morning, you may use the QR code that is shown on the PowerPoint. And those who are not so technology savvy, or you prefer the traditional methods, there are also the offering boxes on your way out that you can put your offering in as you go out, either through the lift or the staircase. Let's give thanks for the offering. Thank you, Lord, for the gift of your Son, whose resurrection we celebrate today. We offer to you a portion from your many gifts and blessings to us. May our gifts be well stewarded and be used to be a blessing to the community around us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Good morning, church. Today I have with me Sister Joanne for the prayer of the people. So in this segment, as we remember Jesus' death on the cross on Good Friday and his resurrection on Easter morning, that gives us hope and reason for our faith. We also want to remember fellow believers who may be suffering and are being persecuted for their faith. I will hand the time over to Joanne for this segment.
Thanks, Elder Tessa. So yeah, even as we thank God that today is Resurrection Sunday, we also want to remember those who are persecuted for their faith, those in hostile and restricted nations, that they may be near-death experiences, and because of their faith, they may be persecuted, and whose life stories are often untold, unheard, and unknown. So we came across this story from Voice of the Martyrs, and this is a story that is actually pretty recently featured in March. It's a prayer update. So let us share this short snippet of this story before we pray for them. So this is a believer from Saudi Arabia, and he is a Christian. So this believer is very open about his faith. And because he was very open about his faith, he was reported to the authorities after he was being exposed as a follower of Jesus. And as you know, in Saudi Arabia, conversion is illegal and it's punishable by death. And so the authorities have opened up an investigation against him. And because of this, his family has also started to threaten him and to harm his family and his wife. And not just that, the Saudi Christians have also been facing some persecution, such as prison imprisonment, prison sentences, and flogging due to this believer's faith. So for Christians facing persecution, their number one request is often prayer. So let's pray for believers that are facing persecution, that they will persevere in their faith despite being in difficult situations. And as we celebrate Resurrection Sunday, we celebrate how Christ has died on the cross and resurrect. May they also know and experience assurance and victory in Christ. So let's take a minute to just pray by ourselves for believers in hard situations to persevere in their faith before I close this segment. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we praise you that today we celebrate Resurrection Sunday. We thank you, Lord, that you have victory over death. We thank you, Lord, that today we can stand in awe of your wondrous deeds, of what you have done for us on the cross, and we simply do not deserve your mercy and your grace shown to us. And today, we also want to remember believers in hard nations who may be persecuted for their faith. I pray that, Lord, would you strengthen them? Would you give them just this steadfastness to continue to just be so grounded and anchored in you despite hard situations that demands them to renounce your name? We pray, would you stir in them such an assurance in them to rest in their hearts and that they will just be so certain and sure that you are with them even when they have to suffer, that they do not suffer alone, but you are with them. And I pray that you continue to just give them hearts and eyes of eternity, that they can look forward to an eternal reward in heaven, that suffering on earth is temporal, that they will continue to just persevere on and to know that victory is theirs because you have overcome death for them. So we remember this our precious brothers and sisters in nations that may face persecution and that we commit them into your hands. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Okay, now closer to home, we also want to pray that the people within our community will get to hear the gospel and for ourselves to be sensitive to these opportunities that we might also be the ones that share the gospel with them. We will also take some time to pray for the many people who are affected by the recent train crash in Taiwan on Friday. Let's pray. Almighty God, our Father, as we celebrate the good news of Easter, we remember those in our community who have not heard of the gospel. We pray for their hearts to be warmed as they listen to the message and for them to respond positively to the gospel message. We also want to remember our friends, families, colleagues, and the people around us who have not heard of your word. Give us the opportunities to bring the message to them and help us to be sensitive to these opportunities, to share of your love and of our testimonies, of your faithfulness and your grace. Equip us with the right words as we share of your goodness. We also remember the families of the victims of the recent train crash in Taiwan. We pray for comfort and strength for the bereaved families. For those who are on board and those who are injured, we pray for healing and recovery. And we also want to remember the relief workers. Give them the strength to continue in the difficult work. We bring all this before you and pray together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The next item is a dance performance by the youths of Katong and Hope Presbyterian Churches. The COVID-19 pandemic has made this a challenging year for all of us. But Easter is a reminder of the hope that we have through the resurrection power of Christ. This dance rendition of the song, I Will Rise, by Chris Tomlin, communicates this eternal hope in the eventual resurrection when he comes again. I will rise.
There's a peace I've come to know, though my heart and flesh may fail. There's an anchor for my soul. I can say it is well. Jesus has overcome, and the grave is overwhelmed. Victory is won. He is risen from the dead, and I will rise when he calls my name. No more sorrow, no more pain. I will rise on eagle's wings before my God. Fall on my knees and rise. I will rise. There's a day that's drawing near, when this darkness breaks to light, and the shadows disappear, and my faith shall be my eyes. Jesus has overcome, and the grave is overwhelmed. The victory is won. He is risen from the dead, and I will rise when he calls my name. No more sorrow, no more pain. I will rise on eagle's wings before my God. Fall on my knees and rise. I will rise. And I hear the voice of many angels sing, worthy is the Lamb. And I hear the cry of every longing heart, worthy is the Lamb. And I hear the voice of many angels sing, worthy is the Lamb. And I hear the cry of every longing heart, worthy is the Lamb, worthy is the
Isn't that beautiful? Yeah, we want to thank God that we can use all our gifts and talents to worship Him. We want to thank the sisters of our youth ministry presenting this beautiful worship to the Lord with dance. Some of us can't do that anymore, but I promise you, one day we'll all be able to dance in the presence of the Lord. I'm going to introduce the speaker to us. The speaker this morning is Reverend Dr. Edmund Fong. Now, Reverend Edmund is both a pastor at Adam Road Presbyterian Church as well as a lecturer at Trinity Theological College, where he teaches systematic theology, theological anthropology, and Presbyterianism. It's a mouthful, right? That's what they do to you at the seminary. Now, Reverend Edmund is a married man with three children and one wife, fortunately. And he's not a stranger to us. He's spoken to us a few times. In fact, if I remembered correctly, the last time he came, he sang us a song. And if I'm not wrong again, he might be doing a little acting for us even today. So, but most importantly, he's going to bring us the Word of God. So without further ado, we shall together welcome Reverend Edmund on stage to deliver today's message.
Thank you, Reverend Kuo Yong. It's my great delight and honor to be back here to share with us on this occasion of Easter Sunday. And that was a beautiful rendition, and I really want to thank the youths for putting up that beautiful item. Like what Kuo Yong said, today will be slightly different. I'll be doing preaching in a slightly different style than the traditional kind of, mainly I'll be preaching from a first-person kind of narrative point of view, yeah? So without spoiling the surprise too much, why don't we come together and just pray and ask the Lord to help open our hearts to His Word. Come, please join me in prayer. Heavenly Father, we come before You, and indeed may the words that are found on my lips and the meditation in our hearts bring You glory and praise. And all the more so today as we remember that indeed our Lord Jesus is risen. We thank You and pray all this in His name. Amen. The sun rises, the birds are singing, the daylight streams in. A new day breaks forth here in Jerusalem city. A new day for us Israelites, living in this great land that our great God has given us, but under the regime of the Roman Empire. It's a new day in the year AD 33, but it is a sad day. A day of grief, a day of despair. A day that for a moment had all the potential of being a different day. But all that potential and hope was taken away in the blink of an eye, in the strike of the nail, in the breathing out of that final breath of life. I'm so sorry. In my grief, I forgot to introduce myself. I am Cleopas, the son of Nahor, of the tribe of Judah. I am one of those living in Jerusalem who have personally seen the great chain of events that have taken place amongst us over the past 3 years. For I am a follower of the rabbi himself, the prophet himself, Jesus of Nazareth. For the past 3 years, I have been following this man, Jesus, going where he went, stopping where he stopped. I have heard his words. I have seen his deeds. I have felt that fresh wave of hope he stirred within all who followed him. I have experienced for the first time a glimmer of hope, a sense of the deeper meaning of this thing that you and I are involved in and that we call life. I have felt all of that only to have all that taken away in the same sudden manner with which it all began. I still remember the first time that I met this man. There I was at Capernaum in the area of Galilee, and there and then, for the first time, I heard that voice proclaiming those beautiful and bold words, words which no Jew has heard for a long time. The time has come. The kingdom of God is near. Repent and believe the good news. Those were the bold words of Jesus of Nazareth, words that still ring in my head, even today. I remember thinking to myself when I heard it, really? The kingdom of God is here? God's rightful rule over all of humanity is here? I remember the excitement. I remember being intrigued by this man, wanting to follow him, wanting to find out more about him. Then I remember the first extended teaching he gave. I mean, who could ever forget that? The Sermon on the Multitude, on the mountainside where the crowds gathered, where he totally surprised us and blew our minds away with what he said. How his words help us to make sense of the Old Testament scriptures we have. How he taught us as God's children to live out the relationship we have with God, our Heavenly Father. How his words really brought out the spirit, the meaning of all that our Old Testament law tells us. His words were refreshing and challenging. And for the rest of my life, I'll never forget the words of this man. You know, listening to him speak was indeed like listening to God himself speak to us. He put in words the experiences that you and I feel so deep within us about this thing called life. He showed us in his teaching and words a closeness to God, unsurpassed, a closeness never seen before in any man. And then there were not only his words, but there were his deeds as well. His healings, they were amazing. The blind see, the deaf hear, the mute speak, the paralyzed up and walking around, those with skin diseases healed with one instant touch. And then there was Jairus' daughter, the daughter of the ruler of the local synagogue around here. I remember word was going around that she was very sick. Some even said that she had died by the time Jesus went to her. But Jesus was able to bring her back to life. And it is so, for many today continue to testify to seeing Jairus' daughter walking around. You know, recalling those days, it really felt too good to be true. The sick healed, diseases done away with, the afflicted liberated, Jesus' healings and miracles reminded us of paradise. It reminds us of the life that you and I long for, that you and I desire, not a life that is plagued and ruled by the presence of sickness and diseases slowly stripping our lives away. But instead, Jesus shows us life as how God intended it to be, well and whole in his presence. Jesus brought us a glimpse of that life. And then there were the other miracles too. The calming of the storm. You know, I wasn't there, but according to the other 12 disciples, the closest group to Jesus, according to what they told me, it was simply amazing. It was out of this world.
The howling winds, the blistering rain, the raging waves, the full force of nature released upon their little fishing boat out in the sea. And all the disciples were terrified. They said, "This is the end." But all Jesus had to do was to speak the word, "Be still." And they told me that all was immediately calm. I remember the disciples telling me that they were scared out of their wits at that precise moment. Somebody who could control the weather and nature like how Jesus did? I mean, who is this man? Only God can control creation like that. Then there were the other miracles as well. The exorcisms, the demons cast out of the tormented with a single word, such that those previously oppressed are now in their right minds. Lives are restored with the work of Jesus. He came to restore the dignity of people. He came to restore the image of God within them. And then there were the economic miracles as well. The feeding of the crowds. I mean, Jesus was able to produce bread and fish just like that. Imagine what he could have done to end all the economic oppression and poverty there is in the world today. And finally, there was the mysterious, the enigmatic character of Jesus himself. He said the most profound things. He hung around the people that you and I wouldn't naturally hang around with. I mean, who wants to be seen around with the tax collectors, the prostitutes, the outcasts of society, the sinners? But Jesus hung around them. And his message around them always seemed to be that forgiveness from God was possible. And in fact, more than that, Jesus himself would be the one to issue that forgiveness. That was the reason why he came, to restore our relationship to God, to bring about the forgiveness of sins, as the scriptures tell us, that one day, the day would come where God himself will come and forgive his people. That though our sins are like scarlet, they shall be white as snow, as our Hebrew scriptures tell us. That though our natural hearts are hardened like stone against God, he will make them hearts of flesh. That's who Jesus was. A bearer of hope in the midst of our dark lives. He came in the midst of our struggle and toil, in the midst of our meaninglessness, and he brought light. He brought hope. He gave us a glimpse of how life with God and under God should be like. Forgiven, restored, perfected. Jesus gives us a glimpse of the world that you and I want, that you and I desire for deep down within us. That is the whole difference that this man, Jesus of Nazareth, made. But perhaps more correctly, I should say, that is the whole difference this man, Jesus of Nazareth, could have made. For he is no more with us. The events of the past 3 days swept away whatever hope that Jesus brought with him. For nobody expected it. That on the day that our nation gathered together to celebrate the Passover feast, on that very same night, nobody expected Jesus to be betrayed by one of his disciples, Judas. Nobody, none of us expected Judas would do that. Nobody expected Jesus to be handed over to the religious leaders who have always been jealous of him and hated him. Nobody expected Jesus to be flogged and punished and then handed over to the Roman authorities for a sham trial. And nobody expected that he would be crucified. And as he hung on that cross, dripping with blood all over, mocked by the crowds, taunted by the religious leaders, abandoned by the closest of his friends, nobody expected him to just bear all of that silently. I mean, surely he who had the power to control nature, to heal the sick, to cast out demons, to feed the crowd, surely he would have the power to save himself. But Jesus did not do that. Instead, he stayed there on the cross, silently bearing all the scorn and the shame, abandoned by the world, abandoned by his closest friends, abandoned by God. And finally, nobody expected him to utter his last words, "It is finished," and to breathe his last breath. And with the exhaling of his last breath, all the hope, all the anticipation, all the expectations that Jesus had brought about were crushed, just like that, just like the exhaling of his very last breath. And now life goes on. The struggle continues. You and I carry on in this world to toil, to labor, only to have sickness and disease laugh that very last laugh at us. You and I carry on in this world only to face what seems to be the inevitable fact that the evil and the wicked keep growing in power while the righteous diminish in number. You and I carry on in this world only to face the decay of all that is around us, this creation, this world. You and I carry on in this world only to face our ultimate destination, the grave. Such is the world that we live in, the lives we live. Such could have been the whole difference that this man, Jesus of Nazareth, could have made. But alas, it was not meant to be. I must go. I've spoken much of my thoughts and feelings. You know, I'm actually supposed to be on my way to meet with the women who cared for Jesus while he was still around. You know, Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of Jesus himself. I'm supposed to meet up with them and the remaining of Jesus' disciples and to bid my farewell to them, to thank them for allowing me to journey with them on this extraordinary journey with this remarkable man for the past 3 years of my life. And then after saying farewell to the disciples and the women, I have to go and meet my friend Jonas. And together we are supposed to make our way to this village, not too far from Jerusalem, this village called Emmaus. I hear that there might be some job openings there for us. And we got to carry on with life. Do remember me, won't you? As I try to carry on with life. Carry on life without the presence of this wonderful man anymore, Jesus of Nazareth.
Now that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. They were talking with each other about everything that had happened. As they talked and discussed these things with each other, Jesus himself came up and walked along with them, but they were kept from recognizing him. He asked them, "What are you discussing together as you walk along?" They stood still, their faces downcast. One of them, named Cleopas, asked him, "Are you the only one visiting Jerusalem who does not know the things that have happened there in these days?" "What things?" he asked. "About Jesus of Nazareth," they replied. "He was a prophet, powerful in word and deed before God and all the people. The chief priests and our rulers handed him over to be sentenced to death, and they crucified him. But we had hope that he was the one who was going to redeem Israel. And what is more, it is the third day since all this took place. In addition, some of our women amazed us. They went to the tomb early this morning but didn't find his body. They came and told us that they had seen a vision of angels who said he was alive. Then some of our companions went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but they did not see Jesus. He said to them, 'How foolish you are, and how slow to believe all that the prophet has spoken. Did not the Messiah have to suffer these things and then enter his glory?' And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them what was said in all the scriptures concerning himself. As they approached the village to which they were going, Jesus continued on as if he were going farther. But they urged him strongly, 'Stay with us, for it is nearly evening, the day is almost over.' So he went in to stay with them. When he was at a table with them, he took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and began to give it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he disappeared from their sight. They asked each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he talked with us on the road and opened the scriptures to us?" They got up and returned at once to Jerusalem.
Could this be real? Could this be true? Did my eyes really see who I thought I saw? Did my ears really hear the voice of the one that my heart was longing to hear? Yes, it is true. It is real. Hallelujah, Jesus is alive. Now I understand. Now I finally see the truth. I mean, how could I have missed it out? How could I have doubted for a moment? Of course, Jesus is the Messiah. Jesus is the Christ, the anointed King. He's the one who come and bring to us God's promised salvation. But more than that, Jesus is not just the King of the Jews, but he is the Savior of the world. He's the one through whom God will extend his salvation to the ends of the earth, to the different nations, to the different peoples, to you and to me. Jesus is God's promise to do something about this broken world that we live in ever since Adam's fall, Adam's rebellion. And how could I have missed it? How could I have failed to see that what was written in the scriptures so long ago until Jesus himself explained it to us? How could I miss the fact that the Messiah had to suffer these things before entering his glory? I mean, as Jesus showed it to us, wasn't it written in the Psalms? So many of the Psalms show us that God's appointed King is the one who suffers, one who is oppressed by his enemies, sometimes even crushed by his enemies. But yet it is God who vindicates his Messiah in the end. Then, of course, there was also the prophecy of Isaiah, the suffering servant, God's righteous servant who comes and who does the work of God, and who in so doing the work of God seems to take upon himself the punishment of all of our sin and iniquities. Now I understand. Now I see. Jesus' going to the cross was not a sign of defeat or a sign of victory for his enemies, but rather, it was the fullest display of his saving work. That in dying for us and in our place, in paying for our transgressions, that is how God himself can forgive us, a rebellious humanity. That is how God forgives every single human being, all who belong to this race called humanity. That is how God forgives you and me. And now more than that, by raising Jesus from the dead, by the fact that Jonas and I just saw and spoke and even ate with the living Jesus, we still can't believe it. It really means this: God has not abandoned his Savior Jesus to the grave. Instead, God has vindicated him, prove beyond all doubt that indeed Jesus Christ is the Savior of the world. And here's the deeper truth. God, in not abandoning the Savior Jesus, is also God not abandoning us. God not abandoning this fallen, rebellious humanity which you and I belong to. God not abandoning this broken world that you and I live in. Jesus came in the midst of our struggle in life, in the midst of sickness and diseases, wars, injustices, pain, relationship breakdown, violence, the decay of our creation and the surroundings. Jesus came in the midst of all this, and he came to give us a glimpse of a different world, a world where there is no more death, disease, and decay. The world where you and I long for and yearn for deep within us. But Jesus did not just come to give us a glimpse, only to take it away and then to smash whatever hope that we have. But by the fact that Jesus is alive, God is telling you and me that Jesus is going to take us to this new world. He's going to bring this world as it currently is towards where God always intended it to go. A world where relationship is made right with God. A world of no more death, disease, and decay. Wouldn't you like that, friends? I like that. And Jesus' resurrection is God's visible assurance to us that He is going to do just that. So now I understand. Now I see the possibility that we glimpsed in Jesus' life and ministry, all that He has done. That possibility has now been made real for us through the empty tomb. You and I can be reconciled back to God. The world plagued by its fallen existence can now finally move towards its glorious destination. In Jesus Christ, God is bringing us to the climax and fullest display of life and relationship with Him and with each other in this world that He has given us. You know, this is so exciting. I really have to let the other disciples know the truth. I have to let them know that Jesus is alive, that our lives and destinies are now changed because of that. The whole difference that Jesus could have made has now indeed been made real in the whole difference an empty tomb makes. I must go and tell them. See you.
There they found the 11 and those with them, assembled together and saying, "It is true, the Lord has risen and has appeared to Simon." Then the two told what had happened on the way and how Jesus was recognized by them when He broke the bread. While they were still talking about this, Jesus Himself stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." They were startled and frightened, thinking they saw a ghost. He said to them, "Why are you troubled, and why do doubts rise in your minds? Look at my hands and my feet. It is I myself. Touch me and see. A ghost does not have flesh and bones as you see I have." When He had said this, He showed them His hands and feet. And while they still did not believe it because of joy and amazement, He asked them, "Do you have anything here to eat?" They gave Him a piece of broiled fish, and He took it and ate it in their presence. He said to them, "This is what I told you while I was still with you. Everything must be fulfilled that is written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms." Then He opened their minds so they could understand the scriptures. He told them, "This is what is written. The Messiah will suffer and rise from the dead on the third day, and repentance for the forgiveness of sins will be preached in His name to all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. I am going to send you what my Father has promised, but stay in the city until you have been clothed with power from on high."
You can't get rid of me yet. Did you hear what the Lord Jesus Himself said? Isn't that amazing? His word to us. Now all of us indeed can go forth and start living lives, start displaying in our lives the whole difference an empty tomb makes.
With the dawning of hope in Jerusalem, folded the grave cloth's tomb filled with light as the angels announce Christ is risen. see God's salvation plan, wrought in love, born in pain, paid in sacrifice, fulfilled in Christ the man. For he lives, Christ is risen from the dead.
Won't you join me and sing this in your hearts?
See Mary weeping, where is he laid? As in sorrow she turns from the empty tomb, hears a voice speaking, calling her name. It's the Master, the Lord, raised to life again. The voice that spans the years, speaking life, stirring hope, bringing peace to us, will sound till he appears. For he lives, Christ is risen from the dead. One with the Father, Ancient of Days, through the Spirit who clothes faith with certainty. Honor and blessing, glory and praise to the King, crowned with power and authority. And we are raised with him. Death is dead, love has won, Christ has conquered. And we shall reign with him, for he lives, Christ is risen from the dead. And we are raised with him. Death is dead, love has won, Christ has conquered. And we shall reign with him, for he lives, Christ is risen from the dead.
Indeed, Christ is risen from the dead. Will you go out and show in your lives the whole difference an empty tomb makes? See you.
Thank you, Reverend Edmund, for the very animated and engaging sermon. Let's prepare our hearts for communion. And shall we rise and sing the hymn, There is a Fountain?
Thank you.
Hallelujah. Jesus has resurrected. The same Jesus whom Cleopas met that day on his way to Emmaus, we are going to meet him as well. And on the day he returns, he shall sup with us. And until that day, we shall remember Jesus with this symbolic meal of bread and wine, where he called us to observe ever so often to remember him. Let us now observe the Holy Communion together as a family of God. And those who are at home, you may also like to prepare bread and wine to share with one another. Together, let us recite first the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Universal Church, the communion of the saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Jesus said, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. Everything that the Father gives me will come to me, and anyone who comes to me, I will never drive away. The Lord Jesus, on the night of his arrest, took bread, and after giving thanks to God, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take, eat, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And in the same way, he took the cup, saying, This cup is the new covenant sealed in my blood, shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. When you drink it, do this in remembrance of me. And every time you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the saving death of the risen Lord until he comes. We shall now partake of the Holy Communion. If you are a baptized member of this church or other churches of Jesus Christ, you are most welcome to participate. Please stand, and we will have the elders bring the communion elements to you. Please hold on to the element and we will partake of the bread and the wine together. As you receive the element, you may like to peel off the first piece of plastic to reveal the bread. Is there anyone who have not obtained the element yet? Please raise your hand. Let us together partake of the bread. Jesus says, this is the body broken for you, my body broken for you. Eat this in remembrance of me. Let's eat it together. Let's give thanks. Lord Jesus, now we understood. Now we understand. We understand that your death on the cross is necessary for all of us. Necessary for the forgiveness of our sins. Necessary to bring us back into fellowship with our Father in heaven. And Lord, because your body is broken for us, it is like the curtain in the temple being torn in two. We now have full access into the Holy of Holies. We now have full access to our Father in heaven. How blessed we are, Lord, to be able to have an intimate love relationship with our Father in heaven, all because of your work on the cross. And we want to thank you for your body broken for us. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Let us now together drink the grape juice. This cup is the new covenant sealed in Jesus' blood. Let's drink it together in remembrance of him. Let us pray the closing prayer together. May we have the next slide? Together, we thank you, O God, that through word and sacrament, you have given us your Son, who is the true bread from heaven and the food of eternal life. So strengthen us in your service, that our daily living may show our thanks through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Remain standing as we sing the closing song.
Onward to eternal glory, to our Savior and our God. We rejoice in Jesus' victory. It was finished upon that cross.
No more guilt to carry. It was finished. rose that we would be free indeed.
One more time. Death was once my opponent.
Death was once my great opponent. Fear once had a hold on me. But the Son who died to save us rose that we would be free indeed. Yeah, He rose that we would be free indeed. Free from every pen of darkness. Free to live and free to love. Death is dead and Christ is risen. It was finished upon the cross.
Receive the blessing. These are the words of the author of Hebrew. He understood the resurrection principle and he gave us a benediction to use for all generations. The author of Hebrew says, "And now may the God of peace, who brought back again from the dead our Lord Jesus, equip you with all you need for doing his will. May he produce in you, through the power of Jesus Christ, all that is pleasing to him. May all glory and power be unto the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit forever and ever. Amen." Congregation, please be seated. Let's spend a few moments reflecting on this resurrection truth.